pretty similar to the Gloria. Let's try it again. One, two.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna.
Just two more. So we're going to sing When We Eat This Bread today. It's going to go,
when we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Try that.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Excellent. And the Amen is easy as well. It's
Amen, Amen, Amen.
Try that.
Amen.
From the weekday masses, it seems like the Lamb of God is the easiest to learn, and it... and it goes on and on.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
Lovely. Thank you. And good afternoon. Welcome to this afternoon's Eucharistic celebration. We're celebrating the third Sunday of Easter. Our opening hymn is in the Green Book, the Catholic Book of Worship, number 405, Sing of One Who Walks Beside Us, 405 in the Green Book.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with you.
Welcome, everyone, on our third Sunday of Resurrection, the third week we start reflecting and meditating on Resurrection. The Easter season is all about Resurrection. All about this great hope that each one of us who is faithful to Christ deserves eternal life. And one day we will be risen like Jesus Christ. Welcome everyone. You always make my day. Whenever you are in the church, I am happy. More you are coming and more people are in, then I have better days. Thank you for coming. And this Mass is offered for the intention of Corazon Humol, for the repose of the soul of Loretta Dizon and Janek family. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess
to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, and what I have done and what I failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary of the Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Thank you.
mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
People exalt forever, O God, in renewed youthfulness of spirit, so that rejoicing now in the restored glory of our adoption, we may look forward in confident hope to the rejoicing of the day of resurrection. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. In those days, the high priest questioned the apostles, saying, "We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name. Yet here you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching, and you are determined to bring this man's blood on us." But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than human beings. The God of our ancestors raised up Jesus, whom you had killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him at his right hand as leader and savior, that he might give repentance to Israel and forgiveness to sins. And we are witnesses to these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." Then the council ordered the apostles not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. As they left the council, they rejoiced that they were considered worthy to suffer dishonor for the sake of the name. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I will extol you, Lord, for you have raised me up.
I will
extol you, Lord, for you have raised me up. I will extol you, Lord, for you have raised me up. I will extol you, O Lord, for you have drawn me up and did not let my foes rejoice over me. Soul from Sheol, restored me to life from among those gone down to the pit. I will extol you, Lord, for you have raised me up. Sing praises to the Lord, O you, his faithful ones, and give thanks to his holy name. For his anger is but for a moment, his favor is for a lifetime. Weeping may linger for the night, but joy comes with the morning. I will extol you, Lord, for you have raised me. Gracious to me, O Lord, be my helper. You have turned my mourning into dancing. O Lord, my God, I will give thanks to you forever. I will extol you, Lord, for you have raised me.
A reading from the book of Revelation. I, John, looked, and I heard the voice of many angels surrounding the throne and the living creatures and the elders. They numbered myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, singing with full voice, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slaughtered to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them singing, "To the one seated on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever." And the four living creatures said, "Amen." And the elders fell down and worshiped. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Christ is risen, the Lord of all creation. He has shown pity on all people.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas called the Twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." They said to him, "We will go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, do you have no fish, have you?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple who Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came into the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 90 meters off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there, with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish. A 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" Because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than this?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go." He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. After this, he said to him, "Follow me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Very long Gospel, but fascinating, extremely fascinating. Jesus prepared a breakfast for them. Could you imagine? One day you will wake up and Jesus is in the kitchen. Pancakes with syrup, egg. How do you like your eggs? That's a beautiful, beautiful scene, that they were with Jesus for 3 years. They knew Jesus so well, and yet there was this moment when they were not daring to ask if this is with Jesus because they knew. But let's start from the beginning. In the very beautiful first reading, we have one of the most powerful line in the Bible. The line goes this way: we must obey God rather than human beings. And this is true. And this is real, that God is more powerful than anything else and anybody else. And we must obey God. Sometimes we can question that, because following God is too much. Sometimes we feel hurt because He doesn't hear our prayers or He doesn't fulfill our wishes. Even in the gospel, if you notice, Peter felt hurt. Jesus, how dare you? You make me feel hurt. We are all about feelings and emotions, especially in this country. Father, this is hurtful. You don't say these words in Canada. Believe it or not, this was told to me in my first week in Canada. You don't use these words, and that's hurtful. Seriously? That's all about the life? To have fun in life and well-being first, so I am well? Of course. Because it depends on this line. We must obey God rather than human beings. If I put, instead of God, my feelings, or I put myself, it all depends how you define God, where you really find God. You don't say to me that words. You don't say this and that. There's numerous examples. Christianity has this one line, that we must obey God rather than human beings. And Christianity, this is what I said this week, because this reading was read this week, which makes my homily easier to preach, that Christianity is divided in over 200,000 branches. So many branches. And if I don't like this, if I feel hurt, I change the church. This is true, but the question is, what kind of God I believe in? Who is my God? And the answer comes with the second reading. My God is the lamb that was slaughtered. My God is the one who suffered passion and crucifixion. And my God took the human nature and He offered it up on the cross for my salvation. That is the God. The God who is not afraid to suffer. The God who is not afraid to tell you the truth. The God who is not afraid to ask you many questions, even if we feel hurt. But we don't like being hurt. Who does? But at stake is something deeper. At stake is something greater. Not only my eternal salvation, but the quality of my life. At the stake, if I have connection with real God, at the stake is the meaning of my life and how I deal with my life. Am I able to forgive? Am I able to forgive myself? Because if I don't forgive myself and God forgives me, am I not playing God? He's able to forgive me, but I don't forgive myself because of the culture, family, because of the circumstances, because I did it. I am a sinner. But most of all, my identity is to be child of God. Each one of us here is equal in front of God. Each one of us is deeply loved by God. God doesn't make any difference if you have numerous family or you observed any numerous family. There is always favorite child and the less favorite. Or the child that is abandoned. Or the child who is missed, left out. But that's a human nature that is broken and missing integrity. God loves each one of us equally, and each one he loves unconditionally. If you sin or you don't sin, if you follow him or you don't follow him, God loves you and me. Me too. This is who God is. So we have this beautiful scene from the book of Revelation. Worthy is the Lamb that was slaughtered to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. This is who God is. He deserves all of that because he sacrificed his life. I cannot be more happy with our church, with our decoration, with our elements of this altar, especially with the cross. I just adore this cross. And I'm so super happy and proud because we have the oldest cross, the oldest on the island. In medieval time, when the theology of sacraments were still in shaping, in the process of understanding what is more important, what is less important, in medieval times, if you read carefully the history of sacraments, we can find that in the medieval times, for a couple of centuries, Catholics believed in 30 sacraments. Not 7, 30. 3, 0. And the first sacrament for Christians, for Catholics, it was the crucifix. Because it was the sign of my salvation. It was precious. It was important. It was sacred. Because he died on the cross for me and for you and for each one of us. So the cross, if you travel through Europe, the oldest Christian continent, if you travel through Europe, you could see so many crucifixes decorated. People were pouring money. They were even putting the last will, that this will should be divided and the cross should be golden or with diamonds or something. There is so many theology of the cross that he died as the savior. So there is also the theology that puts Jesus not hurting, but like a king, and the throne like a throne. And this is what all the apostles remembered. This is what broke them, and this is how we start reading the gospel from today. Before crucifixion, apostles were using the word we, plural. We go, we assist, we help, we come, we go. After the crucifixion, they struggle with this whole idea of resurrection. They don't believe in resurrection because they don't experience. They don't experience the resurrection. That's why this is very, very meaningful line that Peter said to the disciples, I am going fishing. If Jesus not raised from the dead, then we have the church of many individuals. We are not community. And everybody is God. And everybody has his own, her own experiences and visions and worldview. We are united and we are community because of the resurrection. So they join him because there is nothing else to do. And look at this, that's one of the most important lines for this homily. So wake up. Jesus let them feel powerless. Jesus let them struggle. Jesus let them feel that they are lost, and 3 years of their lives went passed away for nothing. He is not risen. They are broken. And Jesus even tells them directly, Peter at that moment, he was about 50 years old. All the other disciples, they were between 30 and 40. Only the John was 20-something. And Jesus says to the disciples, children, because they are lost like children. They feel abandoned like children. They don't have hope like children. Something was finished. Life is not fulfilled. Jesus died on the cross. And then that beautiful moment when Peter is naked, don't turn your imagination, and he jumps to the sea, but before he puts some clothes on himself. That's quite funny, because when you put some clothes on yourself and you jump to the sea, he looked even worse than before he was naked. But he did it. He did it. Because when you put some clothes, when I put some clothes on myself, I look different. Is there anybody who doesn't have body issues? This is too much and this is too little. And I could be higher or lower or something. So we put clothes and we invest a lot of money, and especially ladies, a lot of time to find the proper one. Honey, I found this dress, my gosh. So we feel better. So we can hide from who we really are. And Peter knew that he was getting wet in the sea. But he knew that he is the traitor. He is the one who was appointed, assigned the first apostle, and he denied in the face of Jesus himself. I don't know him. I don't know what you are talking about, woman. No, I have never been with them. Three lines, three times denial. I don't know him. And then Jesus looked at him, and their eyes met. Peter left his family and his life, and he followed Jesus for 3 years. What do we think? That he forgot about his denial? This denial broke his heart in pieces, and this denial was his almost as a nature. I am the one, so I need to put some clothes to hide my shame, to hide my flaws and my betrayal. And then he sees that Jesus prepared food and breakfast. And then Jesus does another miracle, and he performs the same miracle from the beginning when Peter met Jesus. It's a beautiful scene from the chapter 5 of St. Luke. And you know that because after all these encouragements, you read the gospel, right? Thank you. It really makes me happy that you read the gospel. And if you don't, start. And if you have a break, come back. It's always, every day is a good day to start reading gospel. Every day is a great day to come back to gospel. So Peter is the only one disciple who is so ashamed. And every single time when Jesus shows up and he tells them that I am risen, I am not more dead, I am alive, tell this to my disciples and Peter. Because Peter was doubting and questioning himself to the core, because he betrayed Jesus. And he was so sure that he loves so much Jesus. So then the fissure comes and it's ready and it's real. And then Jesus asked him only the question about the love. Do you love me? This is the reality of confession. By the way, every single day is a good day to do confession. Every single time Jesus in the confession and in this gospel ask about only love. Only love. And in the end we have this amazing element, because Peter is the only one disciple that heard the words, follow me after resurrection. After what he went through, after all of that, he deserved finally to hear the words, "Follow me," after he confessed how much he loves Jesus. And in the end, I would like to share with you this. All these modern languages, they do not translate well the dialogue between Jesus and Peter, because we don't have many, many words to describe love. We have only one word that describes love, love. In Greek, we have three words that describes love. Agape, that I give everything and I receive everything. Filio, that I love as a son toward father. And eros, all this erotic love. And here, Jesus, when he asked Peter this question, "Do you love me?" The first question he asked about this full range of love, "Do you love me in the way of agape? Are you ready to give it all?" And Peter says yes. But then Jesus knows better, and he is the God, and he lowers the expectations from Peter. And then the second question, the third question, Jesus asks, "Do you love me in the way of philia?" Look at this, how gentle, how gracious our God is. He adjusts to us. He knows what is in the heart. He knows us and he adjusts to us. He's so gentle. If you can give him 1 minute of prayer, Jesus will be happy. If you give him 1 hour of prayer, Jesus also will be happy. He's so gentle and so understanding. This is the God that we must obey more and rather than humans. We are not gods. We are followers. And Jesus is our King and Savior and teacher and leader. And he loves us abundantly, never judging us. All what we need to do in the life is to love Jesus, to trust him, and never be afraid. Amen.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified by the Roman Spirit, he descended into hell, on the third day he rose again from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of life, and life everlasting. Amen.
With confidence in the risen Christ, let us bring our petitions to our eternal Father.
For the Church, may we as the body of Christ be strengthened by the Spirit in living out the truth of the resurrection, and celebrate the dignity and sanctity of all life, from conception through to natural death. We pray to the Lord. For leaders throughout the world, may the Lord grant them hearts for justice and peace, and be inspired to resolve all conflicts around the world. We pray to the Lord. For the sick and the dying, may the promise of the resurrection give them strength and hope. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
for our parish. May the fount of divine love and mercy fill us with courage, hope, and trust that by your grace, a new pastor will arrive for us, and we will continue to celebrate the Eucharist as a parish community at Sacred Heart. We pray to the Lord. For the intentions of Corazon Yumal, for whom this Mass is offered, we pray to the Lord. For those who have died, marked with the sign of faith, especially Loretta Dizon, our parishioners, family, and friends, that they may share in the fullness of eternal life with Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Almighty and eternal God, source of all life and joy, as we celebrate your Son's resurrection, please hear our prayers and grant them according to your holy will. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
As the gifts are prepared, please take up the green book and turn to 403. Now the green blade rises.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. Blessed be God forever.
Blessed be God forever.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Receive, O Lord, we pray, these offerings of your exultant church, and as you have given her cause for such great gladness, grant also that the gifts we bring may bear fruit in perpetual happiness. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord. But on this day, above all, to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb, who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying he has destroyed our death, and by rising restored our life. Therefore overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts you in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. The fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At that time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion. He took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more, giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Gary our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let's offer each other the sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Our communion hymn is in the green book, number 520-520, Here I Am, Lord.
Shall I say?
Let us pray. Look with kindness upon your people, O Lord, and grant, we pray, that those you are pleased to renew by eternal mysteries may attain in their flesh the incorruptible glory of the resurrection. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We have three announcements, so please be seated. The next First Friday devotion to the Sacred Heart is on Friday, May 6th. And if you joined and you are coming to the First Fridays, starting from September, this is the last one, the 9th. But if you want to start with this one, you just need to follow 9 consecutive First Fridays to go to confession, if you need to. Receive Holy Communion, and do some time of adoration. Just in the foyer, we have these posters explaining the promises that were delivered by Jesus himself to one of the saints, Saint Margaret Alacoque. Everybody who fulfills 9 consecutive First Fridays will be also delivered those promises. Adoration will begins after the noon mass, and benediction will be at 6 p.m. Everyone is invited to spend some time in silence with Jesus. Second announcement, during the month of May, the rosary will be prayed 20 minutes before each mass. And the last one, you are all invited to the farewell potluck next Saturday, May 7th, after the 4 p.m. Mass in the parish hall. Who is leaving? If you would like to contribute food for the gathering or help with the setup or cleanup, the sign-up sheet is in the foyer. 9 months I am here. And one of the goals was this, to introduce the community of Sacred Heart to the devotion of Sacred Heart. This is not a label. This is not a name. It's the enormous depth that comes with that name. Sacred Heart means something. And I've noticed in the very beginning that you are very kind people. And I felt very lucky that I am leading, teaching, and celebrating sacraments for such a kind, kind people. But with the last news that was dropped about my new assignments, I also discovered another feature, another trait of my community. You are very gracious, very, very gracious, and it touches my heart how gracious you are. Everybody was practically saying this one line, this one message. We are sorry and we are unhappy that you are leaving, but you are happy that, but we are happy that you fulfill your dream. And then it moved me because I thought, there is a community that cares about my dreams. Thank you with all my heart. Please come next Saturday. Everybody is invited. And if you cannot come, I still love you. Receive God's blessing. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying God by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Final hymn in the white book from the heart on page 97. The angel rolled the stone away. 97 in the white book.
Thank you so much.